Hello, everybody. It's John Legend. I am a member and honorary co-chair of the Black Music Collective for the Recording Academy. And today we're going to have a free-flowing conversation. It's not an interview. It's just me and this incredible activist, leader, author, Tamika Mallory is here. Welcome, Tamika.
Yay, it's so cool to be with you, John. I'm totally fangirling today. So much for having me.
Well, I'm a fan of your work and your leadership and all the great things you've done to fight for us, fight for progress, fight for justice in our country. Just so excited to have you here and just get to know you and let our academy and our community get to know you better. So let's talk a little bit about music and how, you know, I think so many of us as artists have been influenced by the Black Lives Matter movement of late, of the last few years. You feel like you're seeing it in so much of the art that's being created by our musicians, by our filmmakers, even the increased level of opportunity that we're seeing in film and television. I feel like a lot of that was pushed by people like you, people out there leading protests, speaking out on our behalf and inspiring creatives, inspiring executives to do more to champion our art. So tell me what you think the impact of the Black Lives Matter movement has been on the music business. And then let's talk about how our music affects your movement.
Yeah. So, you know, Harry Belafonte, who is a leader to me and a mentor, I work with the Gathering for Justice, and I know he also loves you as well.
Yeah, I love him.
He always talks about Paul Robeson's statement that artists are the gatekeepers of truth, right? Mm-hmm. And so we always say that when the movements are hot, the music is hot. The music is going to reflect the times of what is happening. And especially since I think in this moment, many of our artists and just people in general are starting to pay attention to the movement as not just a sideshow, but it actually impacts each one of us. And we know that many of the stories we see, it could be us. And in fact, it has been. We see athletes, we see entertainers being stopped by police and having situations. And I think people are starting to take it on much more seriously. And therefore, the music reflects that. It's important to us. While we're on the streets protesting and pushing back and doing the work that we do, it always feels good to have people coming out with songs or tweeting messages or doing things to show that there's solidarity between the artists and the community and the protesters, the organizers. When I think about James Brown saying, "I'm Black and I'm proud," I can only imagine that in that moment, the Panthers and other organizers felt good. Like, you know, this is one of the hottest entertainers saying, "I'm with you. I'm in solidarity with you." And yeah. So, you know, so that's great. And I think what makes it even better is that we know stepping out, taking a stand, using your platform, that doesn't always happen easily. You have managers and executives who are trying to push back, who are trying to soften it. You don't know if it could go the wrong way and whether or not the community is going to accept you and your art, knowing that you may not have been actively engaged prior to whatever you're putting out. And so I always try to encourage artists to be authentic and to speak out, because it actually does help us to keep the movement going. Every single song of 2020 that was connected to the BLM movement, if you will, had an impact on raising awareness and broadening our scope, getting more eyeballs on the work, which is always the goal, is to bring more awareness to what the causes that we're fighting for.
I love that Paul Robeson quote. I've heard Harry Belafonte use that multiple times. And then another quote that I love is that it's an artist's duty to reflect the times. And I said that on the Oscar stage when we accepted the award for Glory. That's a quote by Nina Simone, who's obviously a huge inspiration to me and to many other artists. And I will say personally that it brings me joy every time I see someone marching to the song that Common and I created, Glory. It was inspired by Dr. King, inspired by Ava DuVernay's film, Selma. But we also always wanted to connect the song to what was happening in that moment. So we talked about Ferguson, we talked about what was happening right at that moment in America that was connected to the same struggle that Dr. King was fighting. We are always inspired to see our work connected to your work. And it reminds us why it's important for us to create this kind of music that reflects the times that we live in.
Yeah, you know, I wanted to say we borrowed Glory, but we really stole it.
Hey, it's yours.
We played it everywhere, and I love Common too and talk to him often, and we use that song in every protest. We had our speakers where we would be walking down the street blasting Glory. Yeah. That became really the soundtrack for the movement, not just of 2020, but obviously it's been, I don't know when you guys put that out, but it's been years.
Yeah, I think it was 2014-ish, 2013, yep. Something like that.
Yeah, yeah. Because 2015, Carmen, myself, Linda Sarsour, and all the others that I work very closely with, we marched from New York City to Washington, D.C. And over the time period of 250 miles, we had that song playing and kept it with us to comfort us because the road was long. It sounded good when I came up with the idea. I was like, we should march.
And they that's a long walk.
Yo, well, we're moving through the streets at all day, 20 plus miles a day. We were all looking at each other like, who the hell came up with this idea? But, you know, of all the legislative concerns that we had, all of them have either passed or been reintroduced. And so it was good work, and we used Glory to get us all the way down the road.
Amazing. Amazing. So what are some of the things that you're looking at for the future that you're, when you talk about legislation you want to see passed, when you talk about the frontier of where your activism is right now and what you're trying to accomplish, what are you looking at right now?
My goal particularly is to pull all of us together, you know, working with people like Puff Daddy, and I still call him Puffy. Some people call him Diddy, but I'm, you know, old school.
Yeah.
So, you know, thinking about, you know, he wants to get us organized in a voting block where we're no longer just everybody go for themselves, but that we're being educated about candidates and trying to get people to vote together as much as possible so that we can leverage our political power. So we know on the criminal justice front, which is where I work the most, there are a lot of issues there, and you can't just do an executive order that stops people from killing Black people, right? That stops cops from killing us. But you can do things within the system, put accountability measures in place. You can deal with private prisons, as we saw. The other piece of it is that we have to make sure that we're financially supporting local activists, local organizers, and people running for office locally, because we want people to run who come from the community, who are committed to us, who get our issues, who have a radical way of thinking in terms of reshaping communities and, of course, this nation, but they cannot run on shoestring budgets. They actually need the resources to fight against the opposition, because they're pouring resources in to get their people in office. And, you know, that's something that I think we have to, we've never been taught those things on purpose. So as we're growing up, young kids, no one is really teaching us about investing in campaigns. In fact, they use another trick, which is to make us think that those people are robbing us. You know, they're stealing from you. What are they doing with your money? And there have been some who have not done well, but, you know, with the resources that they have received, and they do give the process a bad name. But we have to keep trying, just the same way that we support corporations and buy products from people who may make a mistake. And once they apologize, we go back and, or we go to a different company and continue to buy products. We have to do the same thing with those people who are running for office in our community and the activists, because activists are the ones that keep the pressure on, right? No, everyone's going to get comfortable if there's no noise. The whole purpose of the marching, the protesting, it's keeping the lights on an issue and making sure that folks are never comfortable and that those people who are not on the right side, that they are exposed. And so we have to put that $10, the $100 or the $10,000 or even more into these groups that are doing work that no one else really wants to do. And I'll say, in line with that, when I think about people like Erica Ford and Reverend Tony Lewis, Tony Lewis may not be Reverend. So let me go back and just say Tony Lewis.
Brother Tony Lewis.
Tony Lewis. He's in Washington, D.C., and he does gun violence work, and so does Erica in New York, and so many others, many that you know. These are people, because, you know, there's this whole, well, what about the violence within the Black community? We don't ever work on that issue. Well, actually, there's a lot of people who are working diligently, and violence would be even higher if we didn't have folks in Chicago, New York, and other places around this country who go out and literally become the only thing between the finger and the trigger of a young person who has not eaten, who doesn't have mental health support, doesn't have parents in the home. That they're struggling, and the decisions that they're making, of course, we don't like them, but we also have to look at the conditions that put them in those types of positions, right? Mm-hmm. And so those groups we overlook. We like to invest our resources in people that we see on the news and, you know, they're out in the streets and doing the protests, and we all want to give to those individuals and to some of our larger organizations. But we have to be conscious to find small grassroots groups that have small budgets, may not be flashy, but they're doing real serious work.
And I love that you brought up folks that are doing violence prevention work in the communities, intervention, trying to get, be on the ground in moments when things could escalate and trying to de-escalate them. And a lot of times there's been a lot of controversy around the idea of taking funding away from policing and investing in those kinds of organizations. But those are precisely the types of organizations that we're talking about providing more funding for. When we're saying, let's move some of that money from the policing budget, from the jailing budget, from the incarceration budget, and put it in places where you could actually encourage more safety, public safety in our communities. And what I always try to remind people is so often the public safety conversation is framed as keeping other people safe from us, from Black people.
Right.
And what we need to reframe the conversation as is we deserve to feel safe in our communities. Absolutely. What can we do? What can our community do? What can the people who are setting our budgets and our priorities do to make sure we feel safe in our communities? What can we invest in? Can we make sure our housing issues are fixed? Can we make sure this wealth gap is addressed? Can we make sure the hunger issue is addressed so that everyone gets the opportunity to feel safe in their community? So anyway.
Can I ask you a question now?
Yes.
On the music front.
Yes.
So why do you, what encourages you to make music about, because you've been doing this before, BLM, so to speak. You've been making music that speaks to the heart and soul of the movement for a long time. Why do that rather than some other type of music? Where did you make that decision that I want to be a conscious artist?
Well, I feel like I can be the full range of my humanity. So I can talk about my love for my spouse. I can talk about my love for my community. I can talk about what I call what some have called the love that you feel in public, which is the fight for justice. Cornel West said, justice is what love looks like in public. And so I feel like I write about love in all of its forms. And I feel like part of what it means to love in public means you love people that you don't even know. It means you you care about what happens to them. You see their humanity. You care about justice for them. And so I write about that too. And I believe artists don't have to choose one or the other. It can be part of your entire story as an artist, because that's part of the story of humanity, that we feel all these emotions, we see all these things. And I do get frustrated because it seems like as a Black artist, you're almost expected that you have to be the one that's speaking out politically. You have to be the one that's the activist, and white artists just get to coast through life and just, you know, just have a good time and be apolitical or whatever. But we feel it. We feel it when we see George Floyd with the knee on his neck. That hits us right in our heart, and it makes us want to say something. We feel it when so many of our brothers and sisters are being left behind, being disrespected, being just treated unfairly and unjustly. So we do feel that, and we want to write about it. But we also feel the range of human emotion. We feel joy, we feel attraction, we celebrate, we do it all in our music. And what I love about Black music is we are able to express all those things, and we are at the forefront of what's happening in music. We always are on the cutting edge of what's happening in music, and so influential, well beyond our representation in the population. Our music has an outsized influence on American culture and global culture. And I think that's something we can be proud of. And we can speak on all these things that are happening in the world and still sell a lot of records and have a lot of impact.
And still be lit, So I have a book coming out on May 11th. It's called State of Emergency. And the foreword of my book, I sat with that. You know, you think the writing of the book is the most difficult part, but it's actually the little things like the acknowledgments and the foreword that you really have to think deeply about in order to make an impact. And I sat with the foreword for a while and decided, I knew I wanted Angela Davis to be a part of it, but I didn't want her as a standalone because I wanted to make a point. And so I had, my foreword is a conversation between Cardi B and Angela Davis.
Oh my God.
Yes.
So this is, have you announced this before? Are we making news right now?
We're making news. We are making news. I mean, I kind of, because the cover has the foreword on it. And so people saw that, and I got a lot of feedback, positive and some negative, with people like, why Cardi? And, you know, what you're writing a book that's about, you know, 400 plus years of shit, excuse my language, I don't know if you can say that on here, that
we curse in the music business.
Okay, good. That we've been through, and they're like, you know, Cardi, I don't see how she fits in. And I explained to people that just what you were saying about the broad range, that number one, I am Tamika Mallory, this girl that grew up in the housing projects in Harlem. I'm a good mix between Cardi B and Angela Davis. Like, I find myself right there. I can be twerking one minute and strapping up my boots to hit the streets the next. And so I wanted that. But the conversation that the two of them are having is so powerful, because Angela Davis is giving Cardi that advice that she needs to keep being what she been, and to keep using her voice. And so I agree with you 100% that we, you know, we're more than one particular thing. We're not a monolith. We live our lives in many different ways, and we have, should be free to express ourselves. People look at me and they go, well, you know, I can't believe that you're saying these things, or that you like certain songs, or you're, you know, friends with certain people. And I'm like, so you can't believe I'm human? You can't believe that as a 40-year-old young woman that I don't listen to music of all types, and that I'm not, that first of all, none of us should have to do this movement work all the time. Like, if we had a choice, we wouldn't be 100% in the movement, the stresses and the, and in my case, you know, we especially around Breonna Taylor and other things that we've led, we're in some of the most dangerous protests happening in this country. Yes. And that's not something that we should be doing. We should be able to stay at home and listen to whatever type of music and have tea and crumpets, but that's not my reality. And right. So I don't think we should box artists into, you know, being one thing in order to be also a part of the movement. I think everyone is welcome at the table. And I don't think that we should box activists into having only one type of one standard of likes and interests to be able to be our full selves.
What do you see when you look at the music industry? Have you thought any about just the politics of the music industry when it comes to race and when it comes to women's rights? Have you thought any about that?
So I think, yeah, I think about it all the time. And, you know, I feel like things are getting better because, again, the movement is strong. And since the movement is strong, I think that across the board, things are changing. It's incremental. Unfortunately, we like to see drastic, radical shifts, but it's incremental. But when I see people like Rhapsody being acknowledged more for her work, that makes me feel really, really excited because Rhapsody is a great supporter of my work and of the movement in general. And I see that she's beginning to get more attention than in the past.
You she's on my album, by the way, Shameless Plug for Bigger Love. We have a beautiful song called Remember Us, and her verse is just gorgeous on it. I was so happy to have her.
Yeah, so, you know, I see people like her and I see what others within the industry are doing to promote people who are using their voices to bring awareness to a number of causes. And so I think that's great. I still think there's some work to be done on the business side and also work to be done in terms of making sure that we're being acknowledged for our efforts and that artists, not me, because I'm not, well, you know what? That's actually not true. I'm on a few songs. I have a little mini album that's happening right now.
Oh my goodness. Well, you got name checked by Beyonce, so I got not many of us can say that.
Yeah, and then I'm actually on a song with Anthony Hamilton. It's called Mercy, and I opened the song, and it's powerful. If you haven't heard it, please, folks should go get it. I mean, it should be Grammy nominated. And I mean, just to think that it's even possible at this point to have songs like Mercy and artists like Rhapsody and others to be acknowledged in this moment means that there is a shift and it's happening. And of course, my good friend and sister, Valisha Butterfield Jones, who is now working within this great network, within this network, that also shows me there's a shift coming because I know that she would not take on any type of role that does not give her the ability to make real change. And so I support her 100%.
I'm so happy we were able to talk, Tamika. It's been a joy just getting to know you better, learning about all the work you're doing, excited for your book, excited for all your musical collaborations to come. Tamika, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you to everyone who's been watching. We are proud of the work that the Black Music Collective is doing, but we want to do better. So please give us feedback on what we're doing and join us if you haven't already in doing the work that we're doing for the Academy and for our community. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity.